It is my pleasure to be virtually here today with you, and I would like to thank the Brain Foundation as well as the organizer of this meeting, in particular Sarkis, for inviting me today to present our most recent data regarding the role of the gut microbial metabolite p-Cresol in autism spectrum disorders. As you all know, ASD is characterized by core symptoms, social communication deficits, and repetitive behaviors. It is also frequently accompanied by psychiatric comorbidities and also by what we call systemic symptoms, which can result from altered immune function or gastrointestinal disorders. The literature suggests that these systemic symptoms could be actually due to abnormalities in the composition of the microbiota, also known as gut microbiota dysbiosis. So what do we know regarding this in ASD patients? Well, a number of studies have shown that the composition of the microbiota of ASD patient is different from neurotypical controls or siblings, with a reduced bacterial diversity, beta diversity, and decreased abundances of the bifidobacterium genus, increased abundances of the Clostridia oides genus. In addition, the levels of microbial metabolites, meaning metabolites whose synthesis strictly depends on the microbiota, are altered in the urine, serum, or feces of ASD patients, and notably aromatic metabolites derived from tryptophan or tyrosine. A recent study on a small cohort of 18 ASD patients has shown that the fecal microbiota transplant from healthy individuals to ASD patients improved the behavior, but also gastrointestinal symptoms. So this body work has led to the hypothesis that the disruption of the gut microbiota-brain axis could actually contribute to ASD. So what is the gut microbiota-brain axis? Well, it is the bidirectional route of communication between the microbiota and the brain through the gut. It uses different systems as relays, such as the peripheral nervous system, the immune system, and the neuroendocrine system. It is believed that microbiota dysbiosis in ASD patients will cause an imbalance in these different relays and ultimately affect brain functions and probably lead to ASD behaviors, notably social behavior deficits and repetitive behaviors. In our lab, we are actually interested in how microbial metabolites synthesized by the microbiota can impact the different systems and could eventually also directly impact brain function and lead to ASD behaviors. In this context, we are currently working on a small aromatic metabolite called p-Cresol or p-Cresol, which derives from the bacterial metabolism of tyrosine. There are two described pathways, a direct one and an indirect one, which leads to p-Cresol synthesis. A recent study has shown that over more than 650 bacterial strains present in the human microbiota are able to synthesize p-Cresol from tyrosine. And importantly, a high number of species of Clostridium are able to metabolize p-Cresol. So why are we interested into p-Cresol? Well, it has been linked in the literature to ASD. Several papers have shown that the urine levels of p-Cresol are elevated in ASD patients, but also their fecal levels. And one study has shown that p-Cresol levels correlated with the severity of ASD symptoms. However, none of these publications really assessed the causality between p-Cresol exposure and induction of abnormal behaviors. So this is actually the question we asked in the lab. Was there a causal relationship between exposure to p-Cresol and ASD behavioral symptoms? To answer this question, we have established a mouse model of chronic gastrointestinal exposure to p-Cresol by exposing mice through drinking water to p-Cresol and using mice drinking regular water as controls. After 4 weeks of this treatment with p-Cresol, we observe an increased urinary excretion of p-Cresol within the range of what is observed in ASD patients. Our p-Cresol treatment did not affect the growth curve, the drink or food intake of our p-Cresol treated animals. But what we were mostly interested in was to look at the possible behavioral impairments induced in by p-Cresol. So we first focus on social behavior, a dimension of behavior which is strongly impacted in ASD patients. We first use the three chamber test in which our subject mouse is able to freely to interact either with a live mouse or with a toy mouse. And then we quantify the time spent in close contact with the live mouse or the toy mouse. A regular mouse will prefer spending more time in close contact with the live mouse, while our p-Cresol treated animals do not show any preference for interaction with the mouse or the toy mouse. This leads to a strong reduction in their sociability index and suggested alteration in their social behavior, which was confirmed using another test, the dyadic social interaction test, in which our subject mouse is in presence of an unknown mouse, and we quantify again the time in social contact and some social behavior events. It appears that p-Cresol-treated mice display a drastic reduction in the time in social contact, in the number of nose contacts, but also in the nose contact duration. So from these experiments, we concluded that p-Cresol treatment deteriorates the quantity and quality of social interactions. When looking at another dimension of behavior impacting the ASD, meaning repetitive and perseverative behaviors through a battery of tests, we observed that mice treated with p-Cresol buried more marbles in the marble burying test and also perform much more same arm returns in the Y-maze spontaneous alternation task. Also, by direct monitoring of motor stereotypies, we observe an increase in the number of head shakes and unpurposed cyclings. So these data suggest that the p-Cresol treatment increases repetitive and perseverative behaviors, but also induces motor stereotypies. We then looked at other dimensions of behavior, not part of core symptoms of ASD, but frequently impacted in ASD patients, hyperactivity, anxiety, and cognition through another battery of tests. And we observe no difference whatsoever between our p-Cresol treated mice and control mice for these different dimensions of behavior. So this indicates that the effects of p-Cresol on behavior are very specific to ASD core symptoms, social behavior, and repetitive behaviors. Then we looked for a possible neurobiological substrate for social behavior deficits. So we focused on a specific brain area called the ventral tegmented area, VTA. Why did we focus on the VTA? Because it is known that VTA dopamine neurons actually modulate the socially engaged reward circuit. And deficits in VTA connectivity are associated with social interaction impairments in children with ASD. Furthermore, VTA dopamine neurons excitability is reduced in a number of ASD mouse models. So we looked using electrophysiological recordings on ex vivo acute sections of brains from p-Cresol treated and control animals. We first looked at the evoked excitability and observed that dopamine neurons from p-Cresol treated mice actually elicit far less action potentials than control dopaminergic neurons. When looking at the spontaneous activity of these dopamine neurons, more precisely when looking at the miniature excitatory postsynaptic current, it appears that their absolute amplitude and frequency are considerably reduced. So this means that VTA dopamine neurons activity is decreased in p-Cresol treated animals, and this could possibly perturb the social reward circuit and contribute to social behavior deficits we observe. We then asked whether removing p-Cresol could restore the behavioral defects which we had identified in our p-Cresol treated animal. So after a 4-week treatment with p-Cresol, mice were subjected to a 4-week washout. And we assessed behavior before the washout, this is the pre-washout condition, and after the washout, this is the post-washout condition. It appears that in the dyadic social interactions test, the deficits which were present after p-Cresol treatment persisted after the washout and were also of similar magnitude. For perseverative behaviors, the same observation could be done with a persistence of the increase in the number of same arm returns in the Y-maze spontaneous alternation task. Regarding motor stereotypies, the increase in head shakes was still present after washout, while the number of cycling was not. Nevertheless, we conclude that after p-Cresol washout, social behavior deficits and stereotypies persist. So this is this led us to suppose that it's unlikely that p-Cresol is actually acting on a receptor at the central level. Furthermore, when asking how p-Cresol could mediate its deleterious effects on behavior, we came across publication which actually showed that p-Cresol production by C. difficile could affect microbial diversity and membrane integrity of gram-negative bacteria, meaning that it could possibly affect microbiota composition. So we formulated here another hypothesis, which was that p-Cresol could induce microbiota dysbiosis, and this in turn could contribute to the ASD behaviors we observed in our mice. So to document this, we performed 16S ribosomal RNA sequencing analysis of microbiota from p-Cresol and control mice. We did not observe any difference in terms of bacterial richness between our groups. However, when looking at the beta diversity, it was significantly impacted by p-Cresol treatment. So we concluded that p-Cresol exposure induced microbiota dysbiosis. To further characterize this dysbiosis, we looked for the bacterial profiles associated with the p-Cresol or the control groups using DSEQ analysis on amplicon sequence variants, ASVs, species, genus, and family level. It appeared that the changes in the microbiota induced by p-Cresol are quite subtle and do not impact broad bacterial taxa. For example, the bacterial taxa associated with control, the control class, encompass several species of Clostridioides, as seen here, one species of Catabacter, while when we focus on the bacterial taxa associated with p-Cresol, it seems to impact mostly Trichomonas species, Christensella species, Anaerostipes species. But what interested us was also to connect the abnormal microbial profile with the behavior. So we conducted a second step analysis using DSTEC, and this time we looked for the association of microbial abundances with behavior. So the result of this association is presented here. So upward arrows point to positive associations with behavioral scores, and negative negative associations are featured by inward hours. We used as behavioral variables the time in social contact and the stereotypies scores. So regarding the bacterial taxa associated with control class, it appears that one member of the Clostridioides genus was significantly associated with the time in social contact and negatively associated with stereotypies. As far as Trichomonas, which are associated with p-Cresol, are concerned, it appears that their abundance associate negatively with social behavior abilities. This is also valid for one member of the Lacnospiraceae, which is also displaying a negative association with social behavior. So this analysis tells us that there are actually relationships between bacterial taxa abundances, dysregulated, and abnormal behavior. And when we're looking more closely at the pseudocounts for each of the different ASVs, which associated with behavior, it appears that ASVs associated with control class, social behavior abilities, and reduced stereotypies, namely mostly species from the Clostridioides genus, are significantly reduced in p-Cresol treated mice. On the other hand, ASVs associated with p-Cresol exposure and social behavior deficits and increased stereotypies, such as two ASVs pointing to Trichomonas muris, are significantly increased in p-Cresol treated animals. So the microbial profiles induced by p-Cresol associate to a certain extent with behavioral outcome. But this is merely an association study and it does not imply a causation. So to test the causality, we perform a fecal matter transplant of feces from control or p-Cresol treated mice towards wild type recipients. We used feces, which we had previously analyzed in 16S analysis. So wild-type mice were transferred with control or p-Cresol microbiota. We allowed 3 weeks for microbiota colonization and performed behavioral assessment of the mice. Quite strikingly, 3 weeks post the FMT, mice which have received the microbiota from p-Cresol treated animals display a drastic reduction in the time in social contact, number of nose contacts, and also nose contact durations. In addition, we observe a partial induction of motor stereotypies with increased number of head shakes, but cyclings not affected. So we concluded that FMT from p-Cresol treated mice induces social behavior deficits and partially stereotypies. Then the next question which arise was as to whether a normal control microbiota would be able to restore the p-Cresol induced behavioral defects. To assess this, we generated another cohort of p-Cresol treated animals, subjecting them to behavioral phenotyping in order to verify that they displayed behavioral alterations. After behavioral phenotyping, we subjected them to an FMT, but this time with a control normal microbiota. We allowed 3 weeks the new microbiota to implant and assess the behavior. Quite nicely, in the three-chamber test, we observed that the deficits in the social ability index, which were present before the FMT, were completely rescued 3 weeks after the FMT, where the animals treated with p-Cresol came back to normal. And we also restored the preference for interaction with the live mouse as compared to the toy mouse in the p-Cresol treated mice, which have undergone an FMT with a control microbiota. The rescue is also visible in the social interaction test, in which the strong reduction in time in social contact, nose contacts, and nose contact duration is rescued to normal after FMT. So FMT from crotal mice clearly restores social behavior deficits. We also asked as whether the FMT for the control microbiota was actually able to restore VTA dopamine neurons deficits. And it was indeed the case, because 3 weeks post FMT, the number of action potentials of dopamine neurons from p-Cresol treated animals came back to normal. So meaning that along with social behavior rescue, FMT from control mice actually restore VTA dopamine neurons excitability. So on the whole, the results of our study clearly shows that p-Cresol induces microbiota dysbiosis with a selective decrease in beneficial taxa and increase in deleterious taxa for social behavior. By manipulating the microbiota, we can either induce ASD behavioral deficits or restore them when we transfer a normal microbiota. Of course, up to date, we still don't know on which systems, on which relays, the dysbiotic microbiota induced by p-Cresol actually induces brain dysfunction and behavioral anomalies. And also, what we would like to know is whether microbial metabolites produced by the dysbiotic p-Cresol-induced microbiota actually perturb the functions of these different systems or directly act on the brain in order to induce ASD behaviors. On the whole, our data support a rationale for therapeutic strategies targeting the microbiota or aiming at reducing p-Cresol levels in ASD patients. And I will proceed with the acknowledgements. I would like to thank the team, and in particular Patricia, who performed most of the experiments presented here, Nicola Caramello for bioinformatic analysis, our close collaborators for behavior, Julie Leroy-Merer and Jérôme Becker, collaborators at Imperial College London, and also at Michaelis Institute for performing the 16S analysis. And I thank you for your attention, and I'm ready to take your questions now.
Thank you very much, Leticia. That was very elegant and very thorough, and a topic that I personally am quite interested in is how these microbial metabolites are impacting behavior in ASD and potentially other neurodevelopmental disorders as well. And so I think your work does a very good job in experimentally identifying a function for a metabolite we know has been, as you pointed out, we know has been associated with ASD for several years now. And there are several studies that have validated that. Let me ask you, while we wait for questions to come in, perhaps I can ask you a couple of questions and maybe just extend that, you know, the concept that you presented at the end of how an altered microbiome, altered by p-Cresol, both exists and impacts behavior. So for example, in your experiments, you provide p-Cresol and that alters the microbiome. But what would you speculate is happening in ASD, where ultimately one would identify an increase in p-Cresol? Where would you think that p-Cresol would come from? Is there an initial insult? Do you think it could be diet or some other effect that alters the microbiome to raise the p-Cresol levels in the first place?
Yes, you are actually asking the questions we are asking at the moment in the lab. It's true that it's, for the time being, difficult to understand what actually causes this increase in p-Cresol in some subsets of ASD patients. There is a possibility that p-Cresol also comes from the environment. You can be exposed environmentally to p-Cresol, and this could directly alter the microbiota composition and and so on, so on, so on. Then, of course, the diet could be involved because it could favor the overgrowth, for example, of strains able to synthesize p-Cresol. And then maybe this in turn will remodel the microbiota and lead maybe to more p-Cresol production and then the altered behavior. But so far, we have not a clear proof of these things at the moment. I don't know, what would be your feeling regarding this?
No, I mean, it's obviously an important question in terms of initially, I mean, once we've identified an individual with autism and profiled their microbiome and the metabolome, something has already happened, right?
And
it's hard to go back in time. It's hard, you know, and I think longitudinal studies may, you know, especially in this population where individuals are identified within a few years of birth, may be possible. But I think until we get to that point where we have, you know, large scale longitudinal studies of children, essentially high risk individuals followed from birth through their first several years, and we know everything about their environment, it may be hard to understand what those initial triggers are. And in fact, what could happen is that in your particular case, the p-Cresol increase may be secondary to something else, right?
Yeah, you know, of course. And in our model, we actually provide it exogenously. So we are not mimicking the real situation, I think. But it's just that we demonstrate, I think, a causality link between high levels of p-Cresol and induction of abnormal behaviors. Then also the fact that when we restore a normal control microbiota to our p-Cresol treating mice, we somehow restore the behavior. It means that there are possibilities for intervention, I guess. I mean, by if you change the microbiota, which is dysfunctional, and replace it by a normal or control one or healthy one, call it whatever you want, there's a way you can actually restore behavior. And that, I think, it would be a good opportunity for the patient.
Mauro, I believe you have a question.
Yeah, good morning. That was a great talk. Thank you. I have a couple of questions. So the first one is related to the concentration of p-Cresol that you are adding to this animal. How this relates to what has been found in humans? Is this about the same ratio or...
Okay, so what we found is that with the treatment we give, we get a 3 to 4-fold increase of urinary excretion of p-Cresol. Then in patients, well, in the original studies, it was around a 2-fold increase, and then several other studies, some of them said there is a 25% increase. Regarding the most recent study from Sarkis, which is on bioarchive, I don't have the real ratio, so I cannot tell you. So you could say it's higher than what is observed in the patients, but I think it's still within the range. It's not that we are increasing by 20-fold or 40-fold the levels of p-Cresol.
Good. And so this is, maybe I missed that, was gavage? And if it were...
No, actually we provide it directly in drinking water. So it's not stressful to the mice. And and they drink exactly the same amount of water as the ones which have water in their bibs.
And were you able to measure whether it goes to the brain? Does it go to the brain?
That's something we are trying to work on. Apparently, the levels in the brain are very low. And we are trying to set up a high sensitivity quantification. But given the fact that, maybe you missed that in the talk, but you know, we did an experiment in which we exposed for 4 weeks to p-Cresol, checked that we had the behavioral deficit, and then we removed p-Cresol for 4 weeks. So unless there is a retention in the brain for 4 weeks of this compound, I think the fact that we still observe the behavioral alterations maybe rules out somehow a direct effect on the brain. But well, since we have not measured it yet in the brain,
the brain is rewired in a different way, and if it's perfectly direct, that could be also explained.
Yeah.
But, just let me ask you the very last question. So I am one of the believers that these changes in reward in the VTA, specifically in social reward, is one of the major drivers of the social deficits, just the social deficits in in those models, not even autism in humans, but I would say in those models.
Mm-hmm.
So I was wondering, this is very interesting results. I was wondering whether if you were to look at a classic reward pathway, let's say conditional praise preference or cocaine-induced plasticity.
Okay, we have not checked.
Okay.
This we have not checked, but it's definitely something that we should check if we want to see whether the deficit in the reward circuitry is more global and not just limited to the social reward. Yeah, it's true. Good.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Ed, do you have a quick question as we're...
Yes, a quick question. Letitia, when you're looking at the microbiome, is it in humans, is it mainly the large intestine, and in the mice, is it really the area downstream of the cecum, or where are you looking at?
Well, actually, I'm collecting the feces out of the mouth. I'm not like, it's not cecal content and it's not colony content. It's just the pellets, fecal pellets, which are expelled.
Yeah, but when you're giving the microbiome back, are you
infusing I'm taking the fecal pellets and making like a nice little slurry and then garbaging the recipient mice with it.
Orally, you're giving it
orally. Orally.
How much of that actually survives and ends up in the large intestine, for example?
That's a very good question, and I have no answer for that. But what I know is we transfer something from the original microbiota, which induces in turn the same behavioral deficits. So we have ongoing analysis, 16 analysis on the mice which have undergone the FMT with p-Cresol feces. And maybe I will be able to tell you more once we have analyzed all these data sets.